aliens. Now, we think about aliens, we think about big heads, big eyes, out of this world. But when the Bible talks about aliens, they're talking about strangers, people just passing through, visiting for a while, living alongside another people, right? One thing that I realized about these aliens is that they had a unique ability, and this is what I told her, they had a unique ability to rejoice in their problems. They had a unique ability because of what God had did to them and what he had given them. Because of who they were in Christ and what they had in Christ, they had an ability to rejoice, what the Bible says, with an unspeakable joy. And then I told her, I said, well, you know, he did the same thing for me. And I'm going to just put this in my words. You know, he picked me, the Bible says, according to his understanding. Something like elect according to his foreknowledge. But it was to his understanding, didn't have anything to do with me. Nothing that I can take credit for. It said he separated me by his Holy Spirit. Right? To the obedience of Christ. And in doing so, I was sprinkled clean by his blood. Amen. I then went ahead and told her, I said it was because of the abundant mercies of God that I was born again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ. And I received an inheritance that it won't spoil. It won't decay. It won't fade away. Bible says it's reserved in heaven for me, kept by the power of God through faith. And then I told her, for this reason, just like them, I can rejoice because for a little while, I had to deal with some things. Because I'm just passing through too. I'm one of them aliens. I'm just visiting. And my faith, which is more precious than gold and silver, though it be refined and purified in a similar fashion, I told her by the heat of the trials of my life, as they come up, they tend to bring up the impurities that I can scrape off that dross. And what's left behind is the remnants of a genuine faith. Pure, waiting to be revealed when Jesus show up. And then I asked her again, I said, now, if God is willing to help you, do you think you could live like one of those aliens? She said, well, maybe. I said, well, let me ask you another question. I said, can you live holy? She said, well, nah, I ain't perfect now. You know what I done been. I definitely not perfect. I said, well, holiness, I don't think holiness is so much about what you do and about what you don't do. I think it has a lot more about who you are and who you aren't. Amen? I told her, I said, when we entered into this new relationship with God, okay, I said, even though at the time of my conversion, I have everything pertaining to life and godliness, but I have to grow up in Christ. I said, so you got to ready your mind for action. You got to be sober, right? I said, even though this thing has something to do with our mind, it's not an intellectual pursuit. You can't earn it. You can't work it. You have to put your hope squarely in the grace of God. But in this new relationship, a couple of things happen. I'm referred to as a child, and he's referred to as my father. Now, if I'm growing up in him, I told her, I said, there's going to be some things I'm going to move away from, and hopefully there's some things that I'm moving towards. As obedient children, he says that we should refrain from the former fleshly lusts, wherein we once lived in our ignorance. Amen. And then it says, as the one who is holy has called me, So be holy in all manners of my life, because it's written somewhere in the Bible, be ye holy, for I am holy. Now, I'm not going to profess that I know exactly what that means, but it reminds me of a story with my son. Now, he was about 4 years old. Leah was one something, maybe almost two. And when I would come home from work, he would meet me at the door. He had to help me with my bag. Come on, Dad, you home from me? Help me with my bag. And we used to like to watch these cartoons together. And anybody seen Tom and Jerry? Yeah, y'all remember Spike, the dog, big bulldog. And he had the little dog that looked just like him. Right? And one day I'm standing there in front of the TV with my normal pose, with my hand on my hip, with my head tilted, looking at the TV, and my wife comes in, she says, look at your son. And I look down, and he was standing there with his hand on his hip, with his head tilted. He was looking at me, and he was looking at the TV, and he was looking at me, and he said, that's my boy. I'm not gonna profess that I got this holy thing worked out, but where I moved, he moved. Where I went, he went. Whatever I did, he wanted to help me. Right? There's something about identifying. This holiness isn't about practices. It's about a person. It's not about rules and regulations. It's about a relationship. So that when God moves, we move. Right? When wherever he go, we go. Whatever he do, we want to help. Is that right? That's what this whole thing is all about. I went ahead and I told Vicky, I said, we not only relate to God as children, but we get to relate to him as Father. And the Bible says that if we address him as the Father who impartially judges all men's work, then we need to respect him as that. I mean, if he's truly the Father that knows all, sees all, is all, then we need to respect him and understand that when he redeemed us not with the gold and silver that is corruptible and perishes down here, but he redeemed us with something that had eternal wealth. He used a commodity that secured our future for all eternity, the blood of Christ. He secured our relationship, not for time, but for eternity. And because if he can take care of all of eternity, I think he can take care of this little bit of time we're down here, right? And likewise, we were born again unto his word. That word was eternal as well. And you cannot be reconciled with God apart from being reconciled with one another. This is the gospel that was preached to us. I let her know. I said, now, in relationship with God, I said, do you think that just possibly you could live holy? She said, well, with God, all things is possible. I said, hey, that's Bible, right? I said, you're getting close. I said, now, finally, I'm gonna just ask you one last question. I said, do you think you can live free? He said, I don't know what you mean. I said, freedom isn't that thing that frees us to do whatever we want. I said, freedom that God talks about is a liberation from the things that we couldn't get away from. I remember my grandmother had a saying, I don't know if you ever heard it, she said, ooh, that baby just got there, can't help it. You ever heard that? I had a cousin, and I might come over and I ask her, well, then, Granny, how's so-and-so doing? She said, ooh, that baby just got there, can't help it. He can't help himself. He can't do right for doing wrong. Now, guess what? We all had the can't help it, right? The Bible says we were in this world, but without God, We were by nature children of wrath. Our best was nothing but mess in his sight, right? So I told her, this freedom that we're talking about is not about you. You already do what you want to do, and that got you nowhere but dead. Dead works, slave to sin. The liberation that God is talking about wants to free you from some stuff. I said, when we are truly free in Christ, we can trust him with our today, our tomorrow, and our future. She said, how do you know that? I said, well, here, let me show you something. I said, you know how we can trust him with our past? It says we need to lay aside all malice, all guile, all hypocrisy, all envy, all jealousy. How do you do that? I said, because prior to God getting in your life, you couldn't. That was you by nature. But now, being in relationship with him, we can. We can confess our sins, the Bible says. Right? And he's faithful and just. Ain't he? It says that he can cleanse us from all unrighteousness. We can lay down our burdens down by the riverside. Amen. We can take off those things that neither us nor, as the Bible says, our forefathers could bear. Ain't that right? So we can let that stuff go. And now we can receive something new. We have this paraclete that helps us and guides us and teaches us. And as newborn babes, we can desire the sincere milk of the word that we might grow thereby. I said, he not only wants to take care of your past, I said, but he wants to take care of your future. She said, really? I said, yeah. I said, God is a living stone, the Bible says. Rejected of men, no less, but he's the living stone. And when we come to him, we submit ourselves as living stones, a living brick, right? For him to put you where he wants you, though he serves as the foundation of that structure, right? He puts you how high or how low he wants you in that structure. We don't have to worry about where we are. We just have to be a living brick, kind of like presenting ourselves a living sacrifice, right? Sacrifice to be offered up, but alive. He's not looking for a dead sack. He's looking for a live brick. And as we trust him, he can take care of our tomorrow. Amen. I said, don't that sound pretty good? Being able to just not have to worry about your future, but God's got you. I said, now, he's also able to take care of your present. She said, how do you know that? I said, because as it's his goodness that leads us to repentance. It's our goodness and our good works that's going to bring about change in other people's lives. He wants us to be followers of Christ and to use him as an example. But he wants us to realize something. Christ didn't repay evil for evil. He did. He was commendated because when he was reviled, he didn't revile back. He didn't replace it with threatenings. It says there was no guile found in his mouth, no deceit found in his mouth. Now, he says, if you do something that's worthy of being punished and you are punished for it, there's no reward in that. You just endure it patiently. He said, but when we are punished with a God conscious for the Lord's sake, and we endure it trusting him when we shouldn't have had to endure it, then God has the ability to do something in there. The Bible says that all things work together for good to them that love him, to those that are called according to his purpose. But when you try to handle it yourself, you get in the way. He wants to do a work. And sometimes because your feelings is hurt because they did this to me and I didn't do nothing wrong and I got to do something. No, you don't. All you got to do is trust him. He will take care of it. He will work it out. And so I came back to her. I said, now, Vicki, one way we know that we trusted in God in the present, because we won't have to fight our own battles when it comes to all these relationships we have. I said, all you have to do is look at our relationships with the government. All you have to do is look at our relationships with civil authorities. I said, matter of fact, all you have to do is look at our relationships within the house. And guess what? You can look at the relationship between you and your mother. I said, now when you recognize that God wants to do something for you and he wants to give you something, do you think you could live as an alien? She said, I think so. I said, in relationship to him, do you realize that you can live holy? She said, I see that. I believe I can with God's help. I said, and with God's freedom, can you entrust your today and your tomorrow and your future in his care? She said, I will. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you and we praise you for being who you are. Oh, Lord, I just pray that this message, this conversation has blessed and done something. There might be somebody here that is in Vicky's shoes, going through, don't know why they're living, can't find a reason to live, have several reasons that they can die. Lord, I pray that you would let them know that there is somebody who can support, who can come alongside, who can help them to live as aliens, who can help them to be holy and can give them a freedom that allows them to not have a care in this world, to have a peace that surpasses all understanding. Lord, we love you and we thank you. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you.
God is so good. Thank you for that powerful message, my son. Oh, God is good. God is good. As we stand together as family, we come to the portion of the service that we open up our arms and we open up the doors of the church family and we invite you to come. If you're here and you're seeking a church home or church family, or if you've given your life to Christ, we invite you to take a step of faith as our new members directors come down front. The doors of Trinity are open. The invitation to membership is extended. And if you're here and you're ready to begin a new journey, take a fresh new step of faith, we as your family open up our arms to you and we invite you to come. It's a simple step. We're not voting on you. We're accepting you. All you need to do is come down front. Let us introduce you. If the Lord is moving in your heart today, won't you take that step of faith? Let that new beginning start right now for you. Just come. The doors of the church are open. The invitation is extended. It doesn't matter. This is your time. Get sweeter as the days go by. Won't you come? You ought to know him. Get to know him. Right now. Today. Just come. The doors are open. There's nothing better than knowing Jesus. The songwriter says it gets sweeter, sweeter as the days go by. Get to know him. The doors are open. Right now. Today. just come. If there's no one who's taking the step of faith today, then we want to join hands as the musicians continue to play. If you join across the aisle and join hands with your neighbors, we'll still keep the doors open and our arms open for you. Just come. Come on, come on, come on. You can still come even though we've joined hands. Today, just with our heads bowed and with our eyes closed and our hearts humbled before the living God, assuming an attitude of prayer as we lift our hands in praise to you, Father God. Once again, I ask that if the Lord has placed someone on your heart, that you lift them up this moment as we prepare to close. If there's some need that he has placed on your heart, that you lift it up and place it on his altar as we prepare to close. If there's someone you know that's unchurched, that you'll ask God to bring them across your path and give you the words and show you the way to touch their hearts in the precious name of Jesus, inviting them to experience the worship experience. And as the days continue to roll by, Lord, that you will give us the strength and the faith to be obedient and to lovingly share the good news of the saving grace of Jesus Christ with those whom you have placed on our hearts and sent across our paths now unto him, who is able to keep you and me from falling and present us faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy. To the only wise God, our Savior, be glory and majesty, dominion and power, now, henceforth, and forevermore. Let all God's people say amen. Holy. Lord God Almighty, God in three persons, Blessed Trinity, God bless you and God keep you. Give somebody a hug before you leave today and invite somebody new to church next Sunday morning. Have a blessed week.